out of the book of James, the first chapter, the 12th through the 25th verse. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it finished, bringeth forth death. Do not err, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Of whom of his own will begot he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Wherefore, lay us apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your soul. Yes. But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any man be a hearer of the word, and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass, for he beholdeth himself, and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty, and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the word, this man shall be blessed in his deed. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word, and sanctify these truths down in our heart. God bless you. May be seated. Truly, we bless the Lord this morning. We thank him, for he is indeed worthy of all praise. We give him praise because apart from him, amen, we'd be like a ship without a sail. We have no home, we have no help, and we recognize that our help cometh from the Lord.
Amen.
So truly, we are grateful, we are thankful, we are encouraged, because God has been good. He's been good. If I would add it up, amen, it would be innumerable. It would be a number that no man could number, because God has been faithful in all that he does. I'm glad that he doesn't just happen or doesn't just do something because I asked him to do it. I'm glad he does it because he's a good shepherd.
My Lord.
And because he's a good shepherd, he takes care and tends to his sheep.
Amen.
What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve.
Rabbi,
use for a word this morning. This would be Father's Day, a day to set aside to honor the fathers, honor the men, honor them that are in a position of responsibility, however the task, how daunting the task, how heavy the task, you're in a position of responsibility, and just like anything else, it is what we have to do sometimes, and there are things that we do only because we seek to fulfill our responsibility. So if I might use for it, word this morning would be man to man, listen up. Man to man, listen up. There is a conversation, I believe, among Christians that ought to take place, and that is that God is faithful. It ought to be an ongoing conversation that God is faithful to do what he says despite of our circumstances. Regardless of what you may or may not be going through, God will do what he says. Does hasn't anything to do with our feelings. It doesn't have anything to do with how we see things. It's just that God remains and continually is faithful on our behalf when we put our trust in him. I personally am challenged every day as a believer to deal with God being faithful, whether it's by fact or by fear or by feeling. I know that God has determined through his word to never leave me nor forsake me. Therefore, I can put my trust in him and tell somebody, whether I'm walking in the street, riding on the bus, in my car, on the telephone, I can tell them that regardless of what is taking place in your life, God will remain faithful because that's just what God does. Aren't you glad that God doesn't change? Aren't you glad he's the same yesterday, today, and forever? I'm glad that we can put our trust in him.
Yes.
Oh God, I thank you. Especially as a man, it's almost threatening and it's almost intimidating sometimes because we, in our own nature, try to make things happen and keep things in place. At least if you're the man that I was raised to be, or even as a boy, they would instill some stuff in you where you had to be responsible at an early age. You had to learn how to make your bed. You had to learn how to say yes and to say no. You had to learn how to be responsible at an early age. So I'm glad that even though you may have peer pressure, even though you may have people that depend on you, I'm glad that I can put my trust in God in this stage of my life and trust him to keep me able to walk in obedience, keep me able to trust him in spite of peer pressure, in spite of what people expect. You know, even as a man, or even a lady, as a woman, God still requires you to be faithful without apology. God says, listen, it's just my standard, be faithful. It's just his standard, be faithful. There's four times in the scriptures that God talks about the just living by faith. Hebrews 10 and 38 says, now the just shall live by faith. Amen. But if any man draw back, he said, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. Four times in scripture, one time in the New Old Testament, three times in the Old, he speaks of basically our mantra is that the just shall live, not by faith, not by feeling, not by what I see, but by faith. By faith, I'm going to, hey, listen, arrive in where God would have me to be.
Amen.
Ooh, glory. Not in what I see nor what I feel, but by faith. Faith is what God expects, for he is the source. He is the catalyst. Amen. And God gives us the power to fulfill our purpose and our destiny as we put our trust, God, I thank you, in him. Thank you, Lord, for faith today. Thank you, Lord, for confidence today, knowing, God, that you are more than able to meet my need. Oh, God, I thank you. This morning, I believe that God has a word, and especially for men today. And if that man will listen, I believe God has a word. Amen. Man to man, listen up. I believe God has a word for you. As I was meditating over this and I thought about it, I said, since it is necessary for a boy to become a man, when you look in the scripture, amen, God expects us to grow from one level to another as we put our trust in him. Proverbs 4 and 1 says, hear ye children the instruction of a father and attend to know his understanding. Attend to know understanding. He says, listen, if you want to grow, if you want to mature, if you want to be responsible, he said, hear the instruction of a father. He said that you might grow from a boy to a man. Mm-hmm. Hear the instruction. Listen to somebody. Take counsel from somebody. And trust me, good counseling today seems to be hard to find. So I thank God that we have this, the word of God, as our standard, so that we can find out what God says about being responsible. Man to man, listen up. God has a word for all that will hear what thus saith the Lord. Amen. Amen. I'm glad that God is personable. I'm glad that God has a purpose for them that put their trust in him. Our key verse is James 1 and 12. It says, listen, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Blessed is the man. I got to read that again, because there's a promise there. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Man to man, listen up. God has a word for you. The blessed man endures temptation and receives the promise of God in its fullness. The blessed man endures temptation, listen up, and receives the promises and the promise of God in its fullness. Ooh, glory. That makes you want to wait on it, don't it? That makes you want to trust him. That makes you want to believe God, because God says, listen, if I determine to be blessed, if I determine to be under, listen, the care of Almighty God, he said, you're going to have to endure some stuff. And in this case, he said, you will be tempted, but if you endure temptation, he said, you're going to, receive a promise as well as be blessed and fulfill the purpose of God for your life.
Amen.
Blessed is the man.
Blessed.
Woo, glory, that endureth. Go through something, take something. We live in an age today where society doesn't have the character to take anything. But God is calling for, listen, for men to have character and strength. Man to man, beloved, man to man, he said, listen up. I've got a word for you. If you endure temptation, if you trust me for the results, then the promise of God can be fulfilled over your life.
Amen.
Because God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. Oh, God, I thank you. There are several things and just certain points we want to touch on today as we go back into our text. But there's certain words of promise and certain words of blessing that God declared distinctly that we ought to do in order to be blessed. How many want to be blessed? God said, you do these things distinctly, you will be blessed. Amen. Jesus said something, he said, listen, Luke 18 and 1, and he said a parable unto them to this day, that men ought always to pray. And not to faith. I know generally he meant mankind, but today I'm talking to men in general and saying to you this, that there's a blessing in calling on the name of God. You want a word from God? Listen, man to man, listen up. There's a blessing when you call on the name of God. God said, listen, you want to be blessed? You ought to pray. You want to be blessed? You ought to call on his name. You want doors to be open? He said, call my name. There's a blessing in calling on the name of the Lord. He said, listen, always pray. Don't get weary. Don't get tired. You may be tired. You may feel weary. But don't let that overcome your need to say, Lord, mercy. Don't let that overcome your need to say, Lord, forgive me. That's conversation. That's man to man. That's listening up and saying to God, you got a word for me, and if I open my mouth,
yes,
I know you'll hear my cry. David said it. He said, listen, my spirit was so broken. He said, this poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and delivered him out of man. Listen up, but God's got a word for you. If you call on him because you ought to call his name, he said, I got a word for you. All you got to do is call me and I'll answer. Ooh, one scripture says, before you open your mouth,
God said, I know already what you had need of, but when you open your mouth, I've already replied to your concern.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Men are always to pray.
My Lord.
Open your mouth.
Open.
Listen up. Yes. Men. Listen up, people. Open your mouth. Ooh, glory. Men are always to pray and not to faint. Oh, God, I thank you for your word. David understood some stuff concerning the discipline before God that he had determined to please God. David was, the Bible said, a man after God's own heart. David sought to please God. He had some bumps and some bruises, but all in all, David had a heart to know God.
Yes, thank you.
David knew what it was to love God. Listen, God used him mightily in the inscription of the Psalms, and God used him mightily in pinning down the very praise of God, the very rejoice of God, the very nature of God was described in the Psalms, and God spoke it. And David pinned it down as God gave the inspiration. David said, listen, there are some disciplines that I practice. There are some things that I do. As a man, I recognize there are some things that must be done in order for God to hear me when I cry. He said, man to man, I had to listen up. I had to understand that God had a purpose for my life. He didn't just throw me as clay against a wall. God fixed it before the foundation of the earth that I would be the man, the woman, the boy, the girl that you are today. Oh, God, I thank you. David said, listen, he understood and he practiced some disciplines. Psalms 1:1, he said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law, he said, listen, he meditates day and night, man to man, listen up. God said, if you want a word from me, you got to discipline yourself. You got to practice some stuff that causes you to walk. Oh, God, listen, according to what I said, you got to mean business. You got to delight yourself in me. And it takes practice. It's not overnight. He said, you got to practice this thing. Man to man, listen up. He said, listen, you want the word over your life? He said, practice some discipline. Practice a standard. Set a standard that only God requires. Set it so that you can walk toward what God requires in your life and be pleasing to God. There's not much said about the man Enoch. Enoch walked with God. He had a long life. But there's not much said about his life. But the Bible declares that Enoch walked with God. Glory to God. And then the Bible said God took him. But before God took him, the Bible said he had a testimony. Not that he built great buildings. Not that he did great things. Not that he was well admired. But the Bible says he had this testimony that he pleased God.
Amen.
And David knew it.
Yes.
He said, God spoke a word over my life.
Yes.
And because of the word over my life and the disciplines that I embrace in my life, he said, God is pleased. Oh, God, I thank you. That's why you ain't got to try to fix it up. You ain't got to try to make it up. Just do what he says. Just do what he says. Ooh, glory. Bible says in the 37th Psalm, if you delight yourself in the Lord, he will give you the desires of your heart. It's discipline, beloved. It's discipline, man. God spoke a word over my life and said, listen, you want to be blessed? You want to walk in my purpose? Have some discipline in your life. He said, and the proof of the discipline is to know that you please me.
Yes.
You please me. Glory. Glory. Glory, glory, glory. Glory, God. Thank you for your word.
Thank you, Lord.
In our text here, the Apostle James is giving some wisdom and some spiritual disciplines for, in this case, men to live by. It's for everybody to live by, but I'm just narrowing it down for men to live by. Looking at our text here, first thing he said to them was endure temptation. And listen up. Listen, it was a word for them to endure so that the promises of God, the blessing of God, will be fulfilled over their lives. Be able to stand against the wiles of the devil as you put your trust in God. It's a discipline. It's a practice. It's something we choose to do. Endure temptation. Amen. So that I can be blessed. Don't fall for the okey-doke. Don't fall for anything and everything. But endure temptation. Saying, Lord, by your strength, I know I can stand. By your strength, God, I know I can make it. And then the apostle goes on a little further in our text. Oh, God, I thank you. And he continues to give them a word, and he gives them dynamics of falling or yielding. I love that song, yield not to temptation, for yielding is sin. So the apostle kind of gives them the dynamics of yielding. He said, don't say that God didn't tempt you, that God tempted you, because God don't tempt with sin. He said, you were drawn away of your own self. In other words, he said, that which you did of your own accord. It was your choice. I hate when I hear men blame somebody when the only blame should fall at their door. So the apostle says, listen, you bless when you endure temptation, but if you fall to the character of sin, he said it's your fault. But we do have salvation. We do have grace, and God will extend mercy and pull you out of your mess. How many times God will pull you out of your mess? God said, I got a word for you. Even in your mess, I'll pull you out. If you call, glory to God, if you call on my name.
Thank you, Lord.
Woo, God, I thank you. Yeah, man to man, he said, listen up. He said, I got a word for you. If you don't yield to it, woo, glory, you'll be refreshed. But even in your disobedience, God said, if you turn to me, listen up. Don't be hard-headed. Don't be stubborn. Ooh, glory. Somebody ought to be able to tell you something. Ooh, glory. Amen. Amen. You can get caught up in yourself so easy to believe that the only voice you hear is you. But he said, there's another voice we ought to respond to, because God has a word, man to man. If you listen up, God has a word for you. Oh, God, I thank you for your word. He said, yield not to temptation, because what? Yielding is sin. Then he goes a little further. He gives some more plain speech, if you will. That's what I love about the epistle of James. It's plain speech and it's exhortation to live. It makes sense. I mean, you don't have to be no theologian to believe this. You don't even have to be a believer to read it. Because James makes it clear of what God approves. And what God likes and what God dislikes.
Thank you.
Ooh, glory. Look at this now. The 17th verse says, he said, every good gift. And he said, in other words, every good thing comes from God. Because God don't change, neither is any shadow of turning. And he said the very word of God to us is word to bring us to him so that God can get the benefit and the purpose out of our lives. God said, listen, I want you to be the first fruit. I want you to be the example of the example I left on record. See, the Lord ain't here anymore in body, but he's here in spirit. So he wants your disciplined life to be an example of the first fruit of creation, so that when men, women, boys, and girls see you, they see Christ.
Amen. Amen.
They see Christ.
and your life. I love this. It's a living epistle that men and women can read you and know which way you're going and know which way you're coming because of the testimony of the presence of God in your life. Have you ever heard somebody say oftentimes, so-and-so wouldn't do that? Oh, no, they wouldn't go for that. But it's not because they wouldn't go for it. It's not because they choose not to go for it. It's because the God in them, all glory, has set a standard in them so that they know what God requires and are willing to walk in the way God chooses.
Yes, amen. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, we could do anything and have everything and be anything, but I choose to follow him.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
My.
How many times have you had to draw a line in the sand?
Amen.
And say, as for me and my house.
My.
I know how you feel. I know what it feels like. I know the struggle you're under. And I know the options that you have, but as for me in my house, I choose God.
Yes, thank you.
I choose God. Because God has spoken a word over my life and caused me to take him at his word. I'm blessed by the best. I'm his because he chose me.
Yes.
So therefore, there's a line I can't cross, man. There's a line I won't teeter-totter on. There's just some things I'm going to make it clear that I just won't do because of him in whom I believe.
Yes.
He don't change.
You know,
his goodness towards me, his mercy towards me. Oh, don't let nobody deceive you. I've been tempted. Woo! And I've been torn. Woo! Glory. But by the grace of God, even when I made the wrong decision, God had mercy.
Yes,
I'm so glad God sees the heart. Somebody always says sometimes, I would never do that. Don't be so quick to open your mouth and say what you wouldn't do.
Good.
Woo, glory. Because by the grace of God, I am what I am. But if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I don't know where I'd be. I don't know what I'd be doing. I don't know who I'd be with. I don't know where I'd find myself in. But God, in his infinite wisdom, spoke a word over my life and said, you're blessed because I chose you.
Amen.
I didn't choose you because you was right. As a matter of fact, you was wrong when I chose you. But I chose you. And because I chose you, ooh, I made you, I shaped you, I formed you. So man to man, I'm listening up because God spoke a word over my life and said, I'm going to bless you.
Yes, thank you.
And has blessed and has continued to bless. Oh God, I thank you. So James continues to give instruction, simple disciplines to practice and wisdom. In the 20th verse of James, the first chapter, he says, listen, man's wrath, mister, your wrath will never satisfy. Your anger will never satisfy the righteousness of God. Listen up. He says, lay aside all filthiness, listen up, naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word. He said, listen, this is not just something I'm saying, but the apostle James says, listen, this is what God requires. Receive the engrafted word that is able to save your soul. Somebody say, I am saved. I don't need to be saved anymore. Yes, you do. We are constantly being transformed and changed. Salvation means deliverance. So just because you got saved today or been saved 10 years, God is still saving and transforming you every day.
My.
so that you become the new creation. I know in the spirit you're perfect, but in the flesh, God is still dealing with some stuff. So he's got to keep transforming you into his likeness. He said he's able to save the soul. God is able to keep you from falling. Oh, God, I thank you. Therefore, he said, be a doer of the word and not a hearer only. It's not that I heard it. If you heard it, you ought to do it. So really, the indication that you heard it is that you do what God says. He said, because if you say you heard it and you don't do it, he said, you're like a man who looks in the mirror, walks away from the mirror, and forgets what he looks like. Listen up, beloved. Man to man, listen up. God's got a word for you. Remember what you look like in the mirror so that God can transform you into his image. Man to man, listen up. God's got a word for you. Don't forget what you look like. Never get to the point that you don't see yourself in the light of God's word. Ooh, this is the mirror, beloved. This is what shows us the real deal. Never forget what you look like, because therefore you can recognize it. If it had not been for the mercy of God, woo, glory, there'd be no hope, and God knows there'd be no change.
Amen.
He says in the 24th verse, he forgets himself and what manner of man he was. So he said, if you look into the perfect law of liberty and continue it, if you look for perfection, if you look for transformation, if you strive to please God, or if you strive to do the will of God, he said, you look into the perfect law of liberty and you won't forget what you saw. You won't forget what you look like. You'll be like Isaiah when God took him up in the spirit and he was in the very throne room of God. And he said, woe is me. I am unclean. Woe is me. He said, my lips ain't even clean. I can't even hold my head up. And God sent an angel, purged his lips, purged his life, and made him one of the greatest testaments to God's presence.
Yeah, thank you.
Don't tell me in the presence of God, God ain't got a word for your life. Ooh, God, I thank you for your word. In the 26th verse, he says, if any man seem to be religious and don't bridle your tongue. Ooh, glory, bridle your tongue. He said his religion is vain and he deceives his own self. Man to man, listen up. God says, watch what you say. Guard your tongue. On one occasion, he says, can a fountain send forth bitter water and sweet water at the same time? If you want to be religious, guard your tongue. We have the capacity to say anything. We have the capacity to do anything. But because we've disciplined ourselves by the Spirit of God and walk according to the Word of God, we've set a standard in our life that everything is not pleasing if I do it or if I say it. Why? Because God, woo, glory, has set a standard and has held my feet to the fire. And every time it seems like I'm trying to ease off of the standard, hey, listen, something begins to burn on the inside. That's why Jeremiah said, I can't stop talking about him, because there's a fire on the inside that's causing me to keep the standard that was first given to me when I believed.
Yeah, thank you.
Ooh, you didn't have to know all about God. All you knew is that he saved you. All he knew is that he changed you. All he knew is that he's transforming you. And the same fire that caused you to walk in obedience is the same fire that stirs you to discipline. Mm-hmm. Ooh, glory. And to be pleasing to God.
Amen.
Man to man.
Man to man.
Listen up. God has a word for your life if you would just listen.
Yeah,
take him
at his word. The only reason you're not hearing is because you're not listening. It's not that God is not speaking. God is speaking all the time. We don't serve a deaf, mute God.
Amen.
We serve a God that's always speaking.
He's alive.
He spoke this world into existence.
Yes.
He holds this world together by the strength of his will. Everything, the glue that everything is held together by the purpose to him to whom we are purposed. The will and the work of God is his because he's sovereign and he's Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Man to man.
Man to man.
Listen up. God has a word for you if you will listen. Discipline yourself by the word of God. Prove yourself by the word of God. Obey God by the word of God. Take God at his word by the word of God. Call on him because he's near by the word of God. Everything that God requires, he backs up in his word. Oh, man of God, woman of God, God has a purpose and a plan for your life. For he has spoken a word over your life if you will listen.
Amen.
Man to man.
Man to man.
God has a word for you if you will listen. God